Welcome back, everybody. The last time we were together, I talked to you about the Independent Samples t-test. In this video, let's talk about it in just a little bit more detail. You might recall that we compared and contrasted the OneSample t-test with the Independent Samples t-test. They're similar in many ways, but they're also different in several ways. The OneSample t-test is based on one sample. That makes sense. The Independent Samples t-test is designed to compare two different samples, so that we can learn about the two populations they represent. In both situations, we're computing a t-test, so we have to locate critical values in the t-distribution. The t-distribution for the one-sample t-test represents a distribution of all possible sample means. The t-distribution for the independent samples t-test represents a distribution of differences between sample means. We'll talk about that in more detail in another video. When we compute the t-statistic, they both represent differences that we see in the numerator, divided by differences we would expect by chance, in other words, some form of a standard error in our denominator. You might recall with the one-sample t-test, we computed the estimated standard error of the mean. For the independent samples t-test, we're going to compute the estimated standard error of the differences between the means. The thing to focus on right now is that we have data from two different samples. So we have variability in both of those samples, and somehow we need to combine them. Combining the variability from each individual group into some type of estimate of overall variability is what pooled variance is all about. Remember that S represents a standard deviation, and S squared represents variance. So this symbol right here represents variance. The little sub p represents pooled variance. Pooled variance is really just a weighted mean of the two variances. Let's look at that in more detail, and I'm going to show you how to compute it. Okay, let's practice computing pooled variance. Let's first remind ourselves that variance, of course, just by thinking about the name, is a measurement of variability. And what it is technically is a modified average of the squared deviation scores. So remember, it was that intermediate step on the way to computing the standard deviation. So we took the sum of squares and we divided by the degrees of freedom. Pooled variance is basically going to be the same type of formula, just looking at both groups together. And you're going to see using that formula, what we're computing is a weighted average of those two variances. Let's change the views. We'll work this out together and I'll show you exactly what I mean. This is going to be the formula that we're going to use to compute pooled variance. The little subscripts just represent group one or group two. We do not need to compute the individual variances for each group, but we're going to do that right now just so I can show you exactly what the pooled variance actually is. Let's go through an example. One sample has sum of squares equal to 63, and the second has sum of squares equal to 45. Remember, I've mentioned several times already, and I'll keep doing this throughout the semester, I'll remind you that sum of squares, which we're going to see a lot all semester long, is simply the basis for computing variance. Sum of squares for the first group is equal to 63, for the second group is equal to 45. So it doesn't matter what we're measuring in this example. We can see that in the first group, there's a little bit more variability than in the second group. Assuming that n equals 10 for both samples, find each sample variance and calculate the pooled variance. Let's go ahead and compute variance for that first group. I'm going to put a little sub 1 right over here. We'll just use our basic formula for computing variance. The sum of squares for the first group is 63, and both groups have 10 people in each. If there are 10 people in the group, degrees of freedom equals 9. Of course, degrees of freedom is just sample size minus 1. 63 divided by 9 equals 7. So our measurement of variability in that first group is 7. Let's compute variance for the second group. Put a little subscript 2. Sum of squares for that second group is a little bit smaller, 45. There are 10 people in that group, so degrees of freedom equals 9. 45 divided by 9 equals 5. Okay, I keep telling you that this formula right here will compute the pooled variance, which is the weighted variance of the two groups. Because the sample size equals 10 for each of those groups, they should be weighted equally. In other words, when we compute the pooled variance, and that formula averages the variability between those two groups, our answer should be right in the middle of both of those values. Let's use the formula and find out. So in the numerator, we take the sum of squares for the first group, which is equal to 63. We're going to add the sum of squares for the second group, which is 45. We're going to divide that in our denominator by the degrees of freedom for the first group, which equals 9, plus the degrees of freedom for the second group, which also equals 9. That leaves us with 108 in the numerator and 18 in the denominator. 108 divided by 18 equals 6. 6. And you can see that 6 is right in the middle, exactly right in between 7 from this first group and 5 from this second group. So far it does look like it's equally weighting the variability estimates from the two groups to find this overall pooled variance. That said, let's test this a little bit further. In the next example, we're not going to have equal sample sizes. Let's take a look. In this example, we're going to use the same values for sum of squares for group 1 and group 2. But in this example, it says now assume that n equals 10 for the first sample, which is the same as it was before, but that n equals 16 for the second sample. So do you see how there's more data in the second sample? When we compute pooled variance, there should be more weight going to that group because we're getting more information overall from that group. Find the sample variances for each group and then calculate the pooled variance. All right, let's compute variance for group 1. I'll put a little subscript 1. Just like in that first example we looked at, sum of squares is equal to 63 in that group. And just like in that first example, there are 10 people in that group, so there are 9 degrees of freedom. So far nothing has changed. 63 divided by 9 equals 7. Variance equals 7 in that first group. But it's going to change for the second group. Sum of squares equals 45, just like in the first example. But now we have 16 people in that group. If there are 16 people in the group, we have 15 degrees of freedom. 45 divided by 15 equals 3. So you can see we have more variability in the first group than in the second group, but we have many more people in the second group. So when we compute the overall variance, the pooled variance using this formula, the value that we find shouldn't be right in the middle. It should favor group 2. In other words, our final answer should be closer to 3 than it is to 7. Let's work on the formula and see if that's what we find. It's an easy formula. We just add up the sum of squares for each group in the numerator. So we'll take 63 and we'll add 45. And then in our denominator, we take the degrees of freedom for the first group, which is 9, and to that we add the degrees of freedom from the second group, which is 15. That leaves us with 108 in our numerator and 24 in our denominator. 108 divided by 24 equals 4.5. 4.5. And you can see that 4.5 is closer to 3 than it is to 7, because right in the middle of 3 and 7 would be 5. So this demonstration should prove to you that when we compute pooled variance, all it really is a weighted average of the variance from the two groups. All right, we're getting really close to knowing everything that we need to know to do our first independent samples t-test. One other thing that we need to know are the assumptions that go along with this particular test. Let's talk about those next. You might recall that when we moved from the OneSample z-test to the OneSample t-test, we started estimating things. And we know that when we estimate things, we're not able to estimate things perfectly. And that simply made the t-test a little bit more complicated than the z-test. And certain assumptions had to be true for that t-test to be reliable, for it to be accurate, for the probabilities that we compute to be trustworthy. Well, the independent samples t-test is a t-test as well, and certain assumptions need to be true for this t-test to be valid. We are already familiar with the first two, so we should be able to go through them pretty quickly. The first is independence of observations. Remember, one person's responses can't be influenced by another, and the reason why I say this is a research design issue is because the way we decide to collect the data is going to influence if the responses we get from one person are independent from the next. In other words, we have a lot of control over that particular assumption being met. The second assumption is that the two populations that the two samples represent must be normally distributed. Remember, this is the normality assumption that we talked about previously. if we don't collect data from the entire population, it's kind of hard to know directly if those populations have data that are normally distributed. However, we can check the distributions for our sample data. If the sample data is normally distributed, you can reasonably safely assume that the population data is normally distributed, because remember, the sample data represents the population. But keep this in mind as well. As long as our sample sizes are reasonably large, which means 30 or more observations per group, then the t-test overall is robust to violations of normality. In other words, even if our data is not normally distributed, as long as our sample size is 30 or larger in each group, we can trust our t-test results. So if you're keeping track, this first assumption we have a lot of control over. This second assumption we have less control over, but as long as our sample sizes are reasonably large, we don't need to worry about it a lot. That's why it's this third assumption that many people consider the most important assumption, because if we violate it, we really can't trust the probabilities that the t-test computes. This assumption is a mouthful. We call it the homogeneity of variance assumption. And homogeneity of variance really just means equality of variance. So let's just call it the equality of variance assumption. Specifically, what this assumption says is that the two populations that the two samples represent must have approximately equal variances. Remember, just a minute ago, we were computing pooled variance. Well, if we're going to combine the variances of the two groups, they need to be reasonably close together. If they are reasonably close together, reasonably equal, we can say that we have equality of variances. In other words, homogeneity of variances. But when one group's variance is quite a bit larger than the other group's variance, we run into problems with the t-test. In those situations, we have what we call heterogeneity of variance. And heterogeneity of variance can lead to misleading results. What that means is we might conclude that we have statistically significant results and we will be wrong. We don't want that. We talked about ways that we can test the second assumption. There are also ways that we can test this third assumption. Sophisticated statistical software like SPSS will run a test for us. If we were to use SPSS to compute an independent samples t-test, right along with those results, SPSS would compute Levine's test for homogeneity of variance. So in that case, SPSS would tell us if we violated that assumption or not. If we're not using SPSS, and we just want to know in general if we might have violated that assumption, we can just eyeball the individual variances. If the variance value for one group is 4 times or more that of the other group, we have probably violated homogeneity of variance. In each of the t-test examples that we will go over, we will assume that we have equality of variance. In the real world, when people discover that they do not have equality of variances, there are some fixes that we can put in place to run a more conservative t-test so we don't need to worry as much about there being problems with our results. Well, everybody, I think we now know everything that we need to know to start working through examples. In the next video, we'll work through this first example. I'll see you then. In the meantime, be safe.